Matthew chapter 3. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to his baptism, he said to them, "Brood of vipers, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore bear fruits worthy of repentance, and do not think to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. Now even now, the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree which does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water into repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." Now, John the Baptist, we've seen how he came preaching and baptizing, even as Matthew had said, in the wilderness. And as we've been looking at John, we've seen that this is a man that was referred to as the greatest who's ever been born amongst women. Now, obviously, that would exclude Jesus himself, but the whole point is that John was a tremendous man of God, and God used him in a mighty fashion. And so I want to show you something to develop an introduction. I'd like you to turn your Bibles with me to chapter 1 of Luke. I'm going to read to you out of verses 15 through 17 and develop something for just a moment with you related to him and the greatness that John had. And I want to apply it in my introduction to us as believers, things that we can learn from John, things that John is described as, that we ourselves as believers might benefit from just by getting some insight from how he's described in Luke chapter 1, verses 15 through 17. You see, in Luke chapter 1, verses 15 through 17, we read, "He will be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will also be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. He will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." What is it that we can gain by looking at John in this fashion? What is it that we can read in this portion of Scripture that can help us to understand what it means to be used by God? Well, one, notice how he's described in verse 15 as being great in the sight of the Lord. He was great in the sight of the Lord, which means that even though he may have the acclaim of man, the thing that was most important to him would be that God would say that he is actually great. You see, a lot of times what we want is we want man to say we're great, but in reality, the greatest "well done" we'll ever hear isn't going to be from our boss or our parents. The greatest "well done" isn't even going to come from our wife or our children. If you're a woman and married to your husband, the "well done," I mean, I appreciate the encouragement when someone says, "That was a job well done." Of course I do. Every job I do for the Lord, I would like to hear somebody say, "That was good. That was well done." But the bottom line, the most important thing, isn't to hear man say to you, "Well done." The most important thing is when God himself says, "Well done." And John was a man who was great in the sight of the Lord. He was great in the sight of the Lord because John was the one who pursued the Lord. There was one thing he desired, like the psalmist said in Psalm 27:4, where he said, "One thing I have desired of the Lord, and that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple." I have one thing. This one thing I do, Paul said. Jesus said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness." So there has to be a primary in your heart, in my heart, a primary motivation. What is it that I love the most? What is it that is the first and foremost desire and passion of my life? If someone were to take you aside and interview you And they said, what is your master passion? Or to take a child, one of your children, or a close relative, and say to them, tell me what the master passion of this woman or this man is. Well, we ought to make it our goal that whomever answers that question would say their master passion, their one overriding love, the greatest desire, is that they might know the Lord, that they might be known as Christian because they love God. John was great in the sight of the Lord. And the Bible makes it very clear when it says that in verse 15, he will be great in the sight of the Lord. That should be a master passion. Secondly, goes on to say, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit. One, to have a passion to be pleasing to God. And even as I say that, I'm so used to saying that kind of thing, I assume naturally that everybody's in agreement with that. Perhaps there are some here who are not. Maybe for you, religion or a relationship with God is not really the most important thing. So the rest of these things I have to say probably aren't going to affect you at all. But if you have a hunger inside of your heart, if you say, you know what, that's really what I'd like. I'd like to know God. I'd like to have a relationship with him, a deeper walk with God. Well, here's something else that would help, because this is something that was descriptive of John, and that was that he drank neither wine nor strong drink and was filled with the Spirit. In other words, he lived what we today would refer to as a separated, Spirit-filled life. Alcohol was not part of his life or lifestyle because he was filled with the Spirit of God. Greg Laurie once said, and I appreciate what he said so much that I'm going to quote him. Greg Laurie said this. He said, it almost seems ridiculous to bring something like this up. Why do I have to say that Christians ought not to get drunk? Because there are some Christians out there today who say, I have the liberty to drink, and I know when to stop. Even so, they will come under the influence of alcohol, and it will make them behave in ways and say things they would normally never do or say. As believers, we want to be under the influence of our God. That is how we are to live as last days believers. Not being filled with spirits, but filled with the Holy Spirit. You want to be used by the Lord? This one thing have I desired. Pursue him. Do not give yourself over to artificial stimulants. John did not do that because he was a man from his mother's womb who was filled with the Holy Spirit. And in Galatians 5:16, it says, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desire of the sinful nature. A third thing found in verse 16 is that he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. That obviously would be the result of the Holy Spirit's filling of his life. He was an evangelist. He had the Holy Spirit's power. He had an eternal framework, and he had a desire for people to be saved. The Bible says it like this, at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. The Bible makes it very clear, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. And so John went forth proclaiming a call to repentance so that people might come to faith in the one God was sending, who is Messiah. He was one who turned many of the children of Israel to the Lord. He was an evangelist. And fourth, in verse 17, he turned the hearts of the fathers to the children. His message led to the conversion of entire families. The message of the gospel is a message that transforms families. As a father speaking to fathers, as a man speaking to other men, I would say that we need to understand, men, that the greatest influence, if you're married, the greatest influence in the home isn't your wife. Now, that may be something that may offend even some of you ladies, but the fact is, it's not. The greatest influence in the home is the husband. And his strength or lack thereof influences everything. And what God has called us to be as men, God has called me to be as a man, is a man responsible, a man who leads that home. Marie and I yesterday, my wife and I yesterday, went to one of these stores in the area. I forget if it's a Home Depot or a Lowe's, one of those stores. We went to go and buy some stuff. You know, I wanted to buy Marie a new lawnmower because she's so tired of pushing that old one. I'm even considering getting her a power edger because she looks so tired when I'm sitting there drinking that tea and watching her work. It really bothers me. So I want to get her a power one. No, we went yesterday. Somebody probably believes that. I'm just kidding. And she and I were walking. I'm picking up some things. I was doing a little work at the house. And this older man, older meaning he was like in his 50s. And a younger man, meaning he was in his 30s, were talking. And as I walked, Marie and I walked past him, the older man had looked up at us, and he worked there at the store, and he nodded and greeted us, "Hi, how are you?" And we nodded and, "Fine, thank you." And off we went, and we went and found whatever it was that we were looking for. And as we were walking back, he was obviously schooling this young guy about something. He was schooling him. And so, because you could see the way he was talking, and the young man's kind of looking at him as we were about to pass. So the older man stops us. He says, "Sir, excuse me for just a moment." I said, "Yes." He says, "Can I ask you a question?" I said, "Of course." And he brings the young guy. So now I've got this young guy and this older guy, and it's obvious he's training this young man, not in the job, but in life. So he says to me, "I want to ask you a question. When you get in an argument with your wife, who wins?" And then he looks down at the young guy like, watch. This is some old guy. He'll tell you the truth. He'll set you straight. So he goes, "Who wins?" And I looked at him. I said, "I do." And he goes, No. "When you get into an argument with your wife, who wins?" Like, I'm so old I couldn't hear, I guess. I said, "I do." And my wife looks at him and she says, "He does." And he goes, "Well, you know, anyway, I'll talk to you." And he turns around and walks in. "So, you know, that's unusual." He said that. He said, "That's kind of unusual. You know, I kind of blew his whole teaching moment, right?" And I laughed. So when Marie and I were talking later on, I said, "You know, it's interesting, honey." I said, "Well, when I ought to say this to you, Marie and I, believe it or not, we really don't argue. So that's not, it's not that we don't have differences, and I have to be careful as I say that. It's not that, you know, that we don't have differences. We do on occasion, then she discovers she's wrong, but that's another sermon entirely." No, when we have differences, we've learned over the years how to handle those differences. Of course there are going to be differences. Men and women living in the same house, of course you're going to have differences. You know, it takes a while for us to be able to, you know, understand one another and learn each other's language. All of that's real, and there's no necessary problem with any of that. But the bottom line is, Marie and I really don't fight. We don't have that. And the reason we really don't is because we've made an effort not to. And I've tried to be a man that loves my wife. So I listen to her. If she is saying something I don't agree with, I'll ask questions. I'll say, "What are you talking about? And what do you mean by that?" "Well, this is what I mean." "Oh, okay, I misunderstood you. I thought you were saying something else." And we learned a long time ago how to communicate without having to pull out the "I'm right and you're wrong" card. And I don't have to, as a man, bully my wife. I learned a long time ago, by loving my wife, she's going to listen to me. By respecting her, she listens to me. I don't have to be right all the time, but I do have to love all the time. I do have to be understanding all the time. I do have to have the ability to listen all the time. That's something God calls me to do. But in the bottom line, when I show that respect to her, she listens to me and gives me respect back. And if you were to ask the average man, "How do you spell love?" the average man would spell respect, because respect is love. And when a woman does not respect her husband, she could all day long say, "I love him." But if there's no respect in that home, there's no love in that home either. That has to be worked out. And so a long time ago, Marie and I learned to communicate in such a way that I try to understand not just the words, but the things behind the words, the things that motivated the words, because there's very often I don't have full information. And so I say that to say it's not as if we don't have our differences, is that we've learned to deal with them. But when it all comes down to it, if Marie and I are having a disagreement, it's not that I'm always right and she's always wrong. It's that together we've decided that we are better together than apart. And our opinions are not so important that they should drive us apart. I am a better man because of her, and she's a better woman because of me. And as we see that, we're able to communicate. Now, I didn't have a chance to discuss that with this man who was trying to train up this young guy. But that's the point I was making. Because I do win all the arguments. But I don't win them by bullying her. I win them by agreeing together that this is better for us. This works best for us. Now, if there's something wrong and she's wrong, my wife will admit it. Now, I have to be honest with you. I'll say this quickly. When we were first married, she wouldn't. She would not admit she was wrong. And I would sit there and I'd say, you know what? This conversation's continuing until you admit you're wrong. Well, you got a long wait. I got a lot of patience. Because I will admit when I'm wrong. I think I did back in 1975, if I'm not mistaken. But you will too. Because we're not going to go in the direction where one person's always right and the other one's always wrong. Either we're both right together or we're both learning from what was wrong. That's how it's going to work here. Now, why did I say all of that to you? Because men have that authority. You love your wife. Respect her. Lead her in the ways of the Lord. Your home becomes better. And John's message was one that turned the hearts of the fathers back to the children, because the fathers have that kind of influence. Husbands, men, you have been called by God to lead. Don't let anybody tell you you haven't. You have been. God created you in that way. So take the lead and do it in a loving fashion. Take the lead. I'm not saying wrestling, you know, best 2 out of 3. I'm saying love, be honest, get in the word, be prayerful. Because if you have a godly woman, you're married to, she wants a godly man. She wants a godly man. That's how it works. Just telling you. And John had that ministry. He turned the hearts of the fathers and the children back to the conversion of entire families. He made, according to verse 17, he made a people who were prepared for the Lord. So the message he had was of repentance. It was for all to hear, and he gave it to any who would listen. And his message was very basic and to the point. The king is coming. Open up. Welcome him. The method of opening up and receiving him is through repentance and faith. And an indication that you are repenting is when you submitted to baptism. Now, that was unusual. Jews normally would not submit to the baptism that John was performing. And there's a reason for it. It's because the Jews considered themselves to be what are called children of the covenant. And because they had Abraham as their father, they regarded themselves as already being believers, and the only ones who were to receive this kind of baptism would have been Gentile converts. See, a Jew believed that because they were under the law, from the time a male was, born and into the rest of his life, he was under the law. At 8 days, he was circumcised and things. He was brought as a son of the law over the time of his life. They considered themselves to be the children of the covenant. Now, the Gentiles, on the other hand, they were not. They were outsiders. They were outsiders. And so if I, as a Gentile, would have been there in Israel, and I see the religious practices of the Jews, and I'm taken by them, I might begin to be what is called a God-fearer. And I might start doing some of the things that they do, because they would regard me as not being quite as bad as an outside Gentile, but I would be a little closer as a God-fearer, and therefore I might contribute to the synagogue or do things of that nature. But if I got it in my heart that I want to be a fully recognized Jewish man, then as a Gentile, the Gentile would receive circumcision, to circumcise the male as a sign of the covenant. And then, after he had healed, he would be baptized, but it was self-baptism. He would baptize himself. Again, the Jews did not regard themselves as needing to be water baptized, because to do so would have admitted they were outside of the covenant. Thus, they would be called outsiders. The Gentiles are referred to as outsiders in Scripture. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11, don't forget that you Gentiles used to be outsiders by birth. You were called the uncircumcised ones by the Jews, who were proud of their circumcision, even though it affected only their bodies and not their hearts. And so outsiders were the Gentiles. The Jews would not submit to water baptism because they were insiders. They were people of the covenant. And yet here comes these Jews getting water baptized, and the people began to wonder why. Now, as they were doing so, John's ministry was becoming apparent. What was he there for? Because the confusion started amongst the religious Jews. They started wondering, why is he baptizing Jews? Well, one, he has already made it clear, and you see that in, and I'll turn back to Matthew 3. You see that in verse 11, when he says, I baptize you with water unto repentance. His baptism was to prepare a people for the Lord, a baptism unto repentance. That's referred to later on in Acts 19, verse 4, when Paul said, John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. He had a baptism that was one that was leading to the reception of Messiah, but he also baptized in order to reveal who Jesus' true Messiah is. You'll see that in John chapter 1, verses 31 through 34, where John said, I didn't know him, but that he should be revealed to Israel. Therefore, I came baptizing with water. John bore witness, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and he remained upon him. I did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I have seen and testified that this is the Son of God. So he had a baptism of repentance. He had a message of repentance, but he was baptizing in order that he might be able to identify Messiah. Now, great numbers of people came. They wanted to hear him preach. They respected him, and they respected his ministry, and they recognized it as being from God. Here's a real basic thing. Here's ministry 101 for some of us in this room, some of you believers. If you want to minister, if you want to minister, and I'm speaking to those who actually want to serve the Lord, if you want to minister and you want to have ministry credibility, then number one thing that you need to remember is you need to be respectable. 100 people, we'll say 100 people, if they were looking at a Bible or looking at you, 99 of them will read you before they read that Bible. Maybe one of them will read the Bible. 99 will read you. And we know that to be true. So you see, if I want to be used by the Lord, then I need to be respectable. I need to be a man that people regard. My father taught me that even before I was saved. My father, as an unsaved man, was respected by friends and family. My mother respected my father. My mother actually would threaten us sometimes by saying, these people respect your father. Don't do anything that causes them to disrespect your father. That's how my mom was with us. Respect is a very important thing. Respect is very important in ministry. And so John's ministry was powerful. Part of the reason, because John, as a Spirit-filled man, was respectable. And the people began to wonder about this man. Just who is this man? As a matter of fact, Matthew in chapter 21, verse 26, simply says, all hold John as a prophet. They saw this man as something else, someone different. And so, as he was going forth and doing this work, and people were coming to be baptized, admitting that they were unsaved, they were outsiders, that was amazing. As all of this is taking place, that was your introduction. Let's get into the study. Verse 7. When he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to his baptism, he said to them, "Oh, the more the merrier. You're all welcome. It's great to see you." No. He said to them, "Brood of vipers, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come?" He did not know how to win friends and influence people. He didn't know how to speak in a way that would be attractive. That to me is amazing. I would never do something like that. I'll be honest with you up front. Who can speak like that? For him to actually address the people in such a way, isn't that insulting? And many people would say, "Oh, you're just undermining my sense of who I am." But John apparently didn't care. And he spoke to them in this way, and I'll show you why in just a moment. But first, let's look at who he's speaking to. He's looking and speaking to Pharisees and Sadducees. Now, you read your Bible long enough, maybe you're just learning to read your Bibles, and you'll read about Pharisees, and you read about Sadducees, and you may not know very much about either one of those groups. Those were religious groups during the time of Christ. Their actual inception, when they began, is lost in history. They don't know exact dates, and there's an awful lot of many studies that have been done concerning their origins and all. But suffice it to say that the Pharisees, during the time of Christ, were regarded as being the ultra-Orthodox, rigidly legalistic branch of Judaism that existed during his day. They were small in number. There were probably around, it's been estimated, that during the time of Christ, there were around 6,000 or so Pharisees. Most of their endeavors and the things that they did were around large cities, especially centered around Jerusalem. And they were regarded as being the most rigid, legalistic people of that day. The Pharisee, the word Pharisee means separated one. They were separated from the other people. And so they were regarded in that fashion. To become part of the group, well, you actually had to go through a probation period of up to around a year. And during that time, the applicant demonstrated the ability to follow the understanding of ritual law. Sometimes people to this day get into rigid rules and regulations to try and prove themselves to be religious. There was a guy who went to a monastery and he wanted to be brought into the brotherhood there, and he had to keep a vow of silence, and they only allowed him to speak two words at the end of a year. Whatever was on his mind at the end of the year, he could speak, but he had to give it, whatever was on his mind, with two words. And so it was a three-year probationary program. So the first year, they say, "Okay, brother, you've been here for the last year. You have the right now to speak. You have two words. What words would you like to speak?" And he'd been silent for a year, so he said, "Bed hard." And they said, "Oh, okay, we'll see what we can do about that." The next year, he's brought back in. Once again, they say, "You've been here for 2 years, and you have two words that you can speak. What would you like to say?" "Food bad." They said, "Oh, okay, well, we'll see what we can do about that." Well, here's his final year, the third year. He walks in. They say to him, "Okay, you've got two words. What words would you like to say?" He says, "I quit." And they said, "Well, of course you did. You've done nothing but complain from the moment you got here." And anyway, I just, that came to mind. We old sick mind, rigid, legalistic, have to do certain things, Pharisee. They were a very proud group of people. They loved to be noticed and were known for the rejection of people in general. If they were in a marketplace and they came out, they would immediately go to wash because they were afraid that they might have touched some unclean person. The Pharisees considered themselves to be what we would call the elite. They were the super spiritual. They pursued small items, excluded the more important ones. They added to the law of Moses their own interpretations, calling them the tradition of the elders. And so here come Pharisees. And then you have, on the other side, the Sadducees. Sadducees, another religious group of people, were very, very liberal. So on the one hand, you have the ultra-Orthodox, the very legalistic and conservative to the nth degree. But on the other hand, you have the Sadducees, who were just exactly the opposite. They were a people who admired the Roman pragmatism. They claimed to follow only the law of Moses, and they rejected the oral tradition of the Pharisees. In Acts chapter 23:8, it reads, Sadducees say, there's no resurrection, neither angel nor spirit. But the Pharisees confess both. So you have one on one side that is rigid, and the other that are extremely free. And they're all showing up at this baptism. Why? Well, they may have suspected him to be a prophet. There was word going out at that time that he may have even been Messiah. Or at the very least, they were simply curious. It is possible that they were religious opportunists who simply wanted to profit from John's ministry. They weren't coming because they needed to repent. They were coming because they could gain something by being identified with him. And that happens to this day. People gain when they present themselves as people of faith. We know that. Every time there's an election, a major election, the presidential election coming up in a couple of years. You know this and I know this. If you've been around long enough, you've seen this many times. I see it every presidential election. I would be so surprised if it doesn't occur again. And it's this. Whatever candidate is trying to get my vote, they will have photo ops of them in church. You will see them walking with a Bible. You will see them with their family smiling after they left a Sunday service. You will see them. That'll be the time that you see them with Bibles going to church. If they get elected, you don't see it anymore. And there's a reason for it. It's so that they can be identified with the moral fabric of America. Nobody wants to vote for president an atheist. They don't want to believe that somebody at that switch doesn't believe in God. And they want people to believe in the same kind of religion that they themselves believe. And you will see this. I've already noticed this taking place. Those that are being trumpeted as being potential presidential candidates are beginning to speak concerning their religious heritage. How so-and-so in my family, my grandfather was a pastor. How my parents taught me their faith because they were Sunday school teachers. And you'll hear that because it's called religious opportunism. And it's possible that these Pharisees and Sadducees wanted to identify with John, who was making such a big splash, so that they could borrow his status and apply it to themselves. And that was what it seems was taking place. What's John's response? He sees right through him. Verse 7, he calls him a brood of vipers and even says, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Vipers. A viper is a very small, venomous snake. And when the viper was still, it looked like a dead branch. And people often would pick him up by mistake. The Apostle Paul did. He reaches down thinking that he's picking up a branch because they're starting a fire, and it turns out to be a poisonous snake that bites him in the hand. And so when John is calling them this, he's rebuking them in a very serious way. He's saying, you hypocrites, your lives and your seductive teaching is from the serpent, and it is deadly. So he asks them, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Now you have to picture this. Why would you say that, John? Well, because after the harvest had been finished and all that was left in the fields were the drying up residue, farmers often would light that field on fire and they would burn it up. And out of the field would come snakes. And that's the picture he's giving right here. Who warned you to flee from the unquenchable fire that is coming? You see, he's saying, what you're really doing by coming to me is you're trying to get some insurance. You're trying to get fire insurance. You're trying to come to me and somehow make sure that you don't perish. But he's reminding them, genuine repentance leads to life. But remember this, insincere religious acts harden the hearts. Insincere religious acts harden your heart. Don't forget that. There are many people who grew up in churches and they sang the songs. They were taught to even raise their hands, to read and memorize scripture, but their heart was not part of that. And when they turned 18, they turned away. And they don't want anything to do with it anymore because they did not really have a heart for any of that. And some of the most difficult people that I ever have ministered to are the ones who've been raised in churches because they already think they know, when in reality, they never experienced anything of the Lord. They just got hardened to the gospel and the goodness of God. So he says to them in verse 8, bear fruits worthy of repentance, and do not think to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. And even now, the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree which does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Bear fruits worthy of repentance. In other words, true repentance will always be evidenced by works of faith. James in chapter 2, verse 17 simply says, faith, if it has no works, is dead. True and faith-filled repentance always results in a new way of life. It results in a changed life. It comes through the renouncing of sin and then living righteously. It's like what Isaiah chapter 1, verses 16 and 17 says, wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes, cease to do evil, learn to do good, seek justice, rebuke the oppressor, defend the fatherless, plead for the widow. He says, don't think that you automatically enter in because you can say Abraham is our father. Simply because you have racial descent does not make you righteous before God. Just because you have a relative that may have had a right relationship with God doesn't automatically mean that you do. In my family, in our family history, I didn't know this. I learned this later as a young man. I had an uncle who was a bishop, a Catholic bishop in Mexico. And I didn't know that until I read my aunt's birth certificate, the oldest sister in my mom's family. And she was from Jalisco, and the bishop, when my aunt was getting baptized here in the United States, the bishop from Jalisco came to baptize my aunt. It turns out that was my uncle. And so my family had a deep religious root that went further than I thought. But just because we had people in the family that had religion in the background didn't mean anything to me. Because if I don't have a relationship with God, I'm just as lost. Because God doesn't have grandchildren. He only has sons and daughters. And so when he's saying that, don't think to say within yourself, we have Abraham as our father. God's able to raise up from these rocks children for Abraham. What was it about Abraham? Well, the Bible says Abraham believed God. It was counted unto him for righteousness. So if you're going to be a child of Abraham, he's basically saying, you need to have the faith of Abraham. Well, they missed the point. They didn't understand. And so he goes on in verse 10, and we'll close in by reading verse 10 through 12, and I'll touch on a couple things. He says, every tree which does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water from water unto repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I'm not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fan is in his hand. He will thoroughly purge his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And so a couple of thoughts. When it says, even now the axe is laid to the root of the tree, and if that tree doesn't bear good fruit, it's going to be cut down and thrown into the fire. So true repentance produces fruit. But a tree that does not produce fruit is of no value and ultimately is simply going to burn. Fruitless repentance is useless. Vines that do not bear fruit were simply cut down and they were burned. He said in verse 11, I baptize you with water unto repentance. My baptism is for repentance because it awakens you to your need for Messiah. But on the other hand, Jesus' baptism is for eternal life and the power to live for the Lord today. This is a baptism. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. When the Holy Spirit is in your life, empowering you, He is also working in your life to purge you. That's where the conviction comes in your life. Whereas at one time you did certain things without any regret, but now that you're saved, there's this sense that I can't do that anymore because that doesn't please the Lord. And His winnowing fan is in His hand, and He will thoroughly purge His threshing floor and gather His wheat into the barn, but He will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Messiah will separate all who truly belong to Him from those who simply pretend that they do. Ultimately, the genuine wheat is separated from the chaff. So the best question that we could have today is, am I wheat or am I chaff? Am I real or am I not? Because for those who are real, you're separated from the judgment. Those who are not, judgment is all that's awaiting. We need to know whether we belong to the Lord today or not.